I came across an old story about a man who was hiking a trail in a state park. And as he's beholding the beauty of creation, he stumbles and he tragically falls off of a cliff. And as he slips down the face of this cliff edge, he barely grabs hold of this branch that's sticking out of the rock. The man is able to grab hold and adjust his footing, and he gets a better hold of the branch. He then looks down again and he begins to panic and cry out for help. Help! Help! Is anyone up there? He's quite shocked when he hears a voice respond, "Yes, this is God." The man, in complete disbelief, cries out, "Oh God, can you please save me?" "Of course I can save you," God responds. The man, with such relief, yells out, "It's a miracle! Thank you, God! What do you want me to do?" And God responds in a way that confuses the man. "I want you to let go of the branch," says God. And after a short pause, the man faintly replies, Is there anyone else up there?" As silly as this illustration is, I think it holds some truth. Oftentimes in life, we face things that seemingly feel like we're dangling off of a cliff edge, barely hanging on to a branch. And we've clung to this little branch sticking out of the rock face, and God is calling us to let go of the branch, let go of your weak, pitiful control, let go of the fear, of the hurt, let go of the bitterness, let go and trust me, God says. But we don't like the means that God uses to save us often. We want God to save us, all the while allowing us to still keep control of our lives, to still allow us to hang on to that branch, because that's what's giving me security. We want him to rescue us from our hurt and our pain and our difficulties, but we don't want to do it his way, because his way is terrifying and it hurts, and I got to face things that I don't want to face. And I think in those moments, which we all have, we have to be honest with ourselves. We have to be honest with ourselves about our lack of trust in God, our questioning of his character in those moments, our uncomfortability with his ways. I mean, if that's what I'm truly feeling, then shouldn't I be honest before God about it? As I just said with the kids. Some of the kids walked up here, you can tell they didn't want to be here. But they're not putting on a front. They're not faking. And sometimes we do that with God. We act like we have all this faith and we trust, but really we know that we're doubting. We don't trust. We look out and it doesn't make sense. And I'm not feeling very comfortable about how God's orchestrating things in life. And so as a child of God, I must constantly be reminded of my hope in Jesus. Constantly, I must lift my eyes to the Lord and his finished work, and away from my affliction and my pain and my struggles, no matter how great they are, that we so often face in this age as we wait for the age to come. And one of the hardest things for me is letting go. Letting go of that puny little branch that I think gives me hope. One of the hardest things for you is letting go. We're all control freaks, really. When it comes to our lives, we're control freaks. And we can be sure that God loves us enough to let us dangle from that branch until we finally let go and trust his faithfulness. Today, I want to fix our attention on a name of God that is truly a gem for the Christian. El-Ameth. El-Ameth. This name is found in multiple places, but I just want to draw our attention this morning to Psalm 31. So if you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and turn there. Psalm 31. This is a psalm written by David. It's a song of thanksgiving. David expresses his thankfulness for God's deliverance. And we're not going to go through the whole psalm, but I want us to see how he starts this psalm. Psalm 31. But first, before we look at the start of it, notice the background behind this psalm. David says in verses 9 through 13, look with me. Psalm 31, starting in verse 9. "Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eye is wasted from grief, my soul and my body also. For my life is spent with sorrow and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my iniquity and my bones waste away. Because of all my adversaries, I have become a reproach, especially to my neighbors, and an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the street flee from me. I have been forgotten like one who is dead. I've become like a broken vessel, for I hear the whispering of many, terror on every side, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. So clearly we see the circumstances of David's life at this point are grim. He's not being phony when he's thanking God for deliverance. David understands what it is to be delivered by God. Just understanding a little backstory here really gives weight to how he starts this psalm. When we understand what he's dealing with in 9 through 13 and how he feels and what he's wrestling with, it gives us a greater understanding to verses 1 through 5. It's from distress and grief within his soul and body that he's proclaiming that God is Elameth. It's from a place of turmoil and rejection that David knows God is faithful. Verses 1 through 5 in Psalm 31. Follow with me. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake you lead me and guide me. You take me out of the net that they have hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. You have redeemed me, El Ameth. Quick side note, do those last words in verse 5 sound familiar? Into your hand I commit my spirit. You don't have to turn there. Luke 23:46. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. David is speaking the dying words of Christ. And that Christ, as he always did, was quoting and fulfilling Scripture. David, in this psalm, is a shadow of Christ in his distress. And yet, what do both David and Christ do in their distress? They entrust themselves fully to Elameth, to the faithful God. The reality for us is that we too have the same rock. We too can turn fully to Elameth in our distress. We have the same rock and refuge that David turned to. We have the same rock and refuge that Jesus Christ turned to as he endured his humiliation on the cross. This imagery of a rock, when God is called that, would have been understood to mean that God is a steadfast refuge. He is an unchanging source of strength and hope. And both David and our Lord, in his humanity, run to the rock. Guys, there are few things that arouse and strengthen our faith and comfort us in trying times like the faithfulness of God. As A.W. Pink said, God is true. His word of promise is sure. In all his relations with his people, God is faithful. He may be safely relied upon. No one ever yet really trusted him in vain. We find this precious truth expressed almost everywhere in the Scriptures. For his people need to know that faithfulness is an essential part of the divine character. This is the basis of our confidence in him. Why can I have the utmost assurance and confidence in Christ? And not when life is good. It's easy to trust him when life is good. When my life is falling apart. Why can I come to Christ and be assured and have confidence? He's eternally, infinitely, and perfectly faithful. He is Elameth. But what does it mean that God is faithful? Well, simply put, it means that God is completely and totally trustworthy. that God is right and sure in all that He does, says, and is. I love what Psalm 89:8 says. Lord God of armies, who is like you, mighty Lord? Your faithfulness surrounds you. God's faithfulness surrounds Him. This is really overwhelming when you think about it. The Bible says that God surrounds His people. And if God's faithfulness surrounds Him, then that means His faithfulness surrounds us. Which means that constantly in my life, God's faithfulness is before me. It's behind me. It's beside me. It encompasses me. If I am a Christian, then I can be absolutely sure that everything in my life is an expression touched by the faithfulness of Elimeth. Everything. No matter what it feels like, no matter what kind of destruction comes with it, as Pink said, God's people need to know that God is faithful. It's the basis for our confidence. Now, what's beautiful is that we see the same root word used for both faithfulness and truth in the Old Testament. It means firmness or steadfastness. So this reveals to us that faithfulness and truth are hand in glove. Whatever is true must be faithful or it ceases to be true. This is why John says of Jesus in Revelation 19:11, "Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war." In Revelation 3:14, Jesus calls himself the Amen and the Faithful and True Witness. Interesting fact. Both words, the Amen and our word, Emeth, come from the same Hebrew word which means to be confirmed as faithful and true. Jesus, calling himself the Amen, is also calling himself Elimeth, the faithful God. Revelation 21:5, "Then he who sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write, for these words are true and faithful." And likewise, Revelation 22:6, "And he said to me, These words," what words? God's words, "are trustworthy and true." And because Elimeth is faithful, we have an eternal, unwavering hope in him. Do I believe that this morning? Do I believe that my hope in Christ is unwavering, that it's unshakable? We're going to get more into this as to how it remains that way. But do I believe that this morning? Regardless of what's going on outside of these doors, what's going on inside of my heart and my mind, and as David said, I'm in distress in my body and my soul. Our God is faithful and true, and He can be fully trusted. It's really the John 6 reality. Where else are we going to go, Lord? You alone have the words of eternal life. There's nowhere else to go to find truth, to find eternal life, but Jesus Christ. But first, with our remaining time, I want to look at how God is faithful, or how His faithfulness is seen in our lives, so that we would be reminded this morning of His faithfulness, that we would be strengthened by who our God is, and that in Him we would take refuge. But first, speaking of God's words being faithful and true, we have to know this. I know I kind of just said that, but I want to drive this point home a little bit. We have to know that God is faithful to His promises. And if I don't know that, then I need to give myself to the Lord and ask Him to show me that and drive that into my heart, that I would know. Because knowing that He is faithful is the foundation of "Into Your Hands I Commit My Spirit." If you don't believe God is faithful, you're not saying, "Into Your hands I commit my spirit." You're saying, "Into my own hands I commit my spirit," because I don't trust God. Joshua's dying words to Israel are saturated with this truth about God. Joshua 23, verse 14. And now I'm about to go the way of all the earth. He's about to die. And you know in your hearts and souls, all of you, that not one word has failed of all the good things that the Lord your God promised concerning you. All have come to pass for you. Not one of them has failed. Joshua's final words were to remind the Israelites of God and his faithfulness, to remind them that not a single word of God has failed, nor will it fail. Do you know in your heart and soul, all of you, that not one word of God has failed or will fail? Do you know in your heart and in your soul that every single promise of God will be fulfilled exactly as He's promised? Do you know this? Not just in your head and give an intellectual amen, but as Joshua says, you know this in your heart and soul because you've experienced it. You've seen God show up day in, day out. And more than that, you look to Calvary and see the pinnacle of God's faithfulness. I mean, think about this. If we don't believe or don't know that this is true, how do you think this plays out in our lives? I mean, what are the consequences of this? Well, what kind of relationship do you have with somebody that you don't trust? Not a very close one, right? You're guarded with them. You only allow as far as your trust for them will permit. You're never really vulnerable with that person because you've been hurt. God, you allowed this to happen and this hurt me, and now I cannot trust you again because I'm afraid I'm going to get hurt again. And so this person that I don't really trust is probably the last person that I call for help, right? I don't trust them. I call people that I trust when I need help. So this is crucial for us to examine ourselves and determine what we truly believe about God. That I would become like a child and be honest with whether or not I actually trust God, because it's this doubt of God's faithfulness that keeps me holding on to that pitiful little branch and trusting Him, as LJ said, trusting in my own righteousness, trusting in my own resources, in my own ability to endure and get through this. I'll be a stronger person, I'll hold my head high, and I'll march on through this. No. Because our problem is bigger than we are. Getting sidetracked. Now, even though He's always faithful to His promise, we don't always see that faithfulness when we look at how He goes about bringing forth those promises, right? Well, God said, He promised to do this, but right now I look at my life and I don't see how this is going to, I can't connect these dots. How are you going to get me to here? You said you're going to get me here, but I'm over here and I don't see this path. But we don't get to determine God's faithfulness by what we see happening around us. I don't get to look at my circumstances, my tragic circumstances, and use that as the litmus test to determine whether or not God's faithful. Because what happens is I start judging God by whether or not He's fixing what I think He needs to fix. That's a dangerous place to arrive. I must go to the Word of God to be assured of His faithfulness. I must look to Calvary to be assured of His faithfulness. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, as He hangs on this cross. I look to that and see His faithfulness. Not my bleak and dark circumstances. Abraham and Sarah are really great examples for us in this. God promised a son to Abraham and Sarah at a time where in the natural realm it didn't make sense. We can't even have a child. And I would argue they weren't really completely sold on what God had said at first. I mean, yeah, they believe, but this is revealed in their response to God's promise. They both laughed at Him. They laughed at the thought of having a child at their age. But the laughter turned to faith. The doubt turned to trust. And despite what it looked like on the surface, they knew God was faithful and would bring about His promise regardless of what they could see. And they waited years 25 years. They were fallen humans like us. They weren't super Christians that never doubt or never stumble. They were tempted to doubt and question. It didn't make sense at times as to how God was going to fulfill His promise. But by faith, they trusted God to be faithful and His word to be true. The New Testament shows us this. Romans 4, 19 through 21, speaking of Abraham, he did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was good as dead since he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. When Abraham looked at his own body, his old shriveled body, and he looked at the barrenness of Sarah's womb, he did not weaken in faith. No unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God. Rather, he drew near to God. He gave God glory. He trusted God. And in that was fully convinced that God would do what he said. You see, family, the issue is not whether or not we doubt or question how God's going to be faithful. That's true for all of us. It's the way we go about dealing with it. Rather than go to God and seek Him at His word and grow strong in faith as Abraham did, we try to rationalize and make sense of our circumstances and what we think God should do in our own mind. But that's not faith. That's leaning on my own understanding. Be honest with yourself. As I said at first, I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief. If you think you always have faith, and I've said this, but we hear this. Well, I always have faith. No, you don't. No, you don't. We all have lapses where we doubt, where we look out, we say, wait a second, I don't trust you right now, God, but I'm here, and I'm struggling, and you are greater than my heart when my heart condemns me. I believe, but help my unbelief. Go to God in my doubt and my questioning. I open my Bible. I learn the promises of God and see that He was faithful then and He's faithful now. Why? Because it's who He is. He cannot change. Even though circumstances in my life don't seem to line up with what God has promised and I can't make sense of it, I consider Him faithful who promised to never leave me nor forsake me. I consider Him faithful who has already suffered and died and rose on my behalf. So I cannot determine God's faithfulness based off my circumstances. And the reality is God is doing far beyond what we're able to comprehend. He's doing so much more than we can even begin to grasp. And it's our faith that says, I know what it looks like and it doesn't make sense, but I will remember that He who promised is faithful. He said it, surely He will do it. Hebrews 10:23, let us hold fast, hold tightly to the confession of our hope without wavering, for He who promised is faithful. Now, how is God's faithfulness seen or expressed to us as His children? We're going to look at a few points. I only have four of them. Firstly, Elameth is faithful in our salvation. 1 Thessalonians 5, 23 and 24, this was Pastor Greg's benediction last week. Now may the God of peace Himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. My salvation is in the hands of Christ. And because He is faithful, He will surely complete His work in me and keep me blameless until He comes back for me. This is important for us to understand. As LJ said, there's a fine line that often gets blurred between my own righteousness that's evidenced by my morality and trying to be good and the work of grace in my life that has nothing to do with me. Trusting in God's faithfulness to finish His work in us frees us to grow in His grace. This liberates me because I recognize that any good in me, it's His faithful work. Period. But even when I sin, it's trusting in His faithfulness that leads me to go to Him when I sin. Jesus is our faithful high priest. And as our faithful high priest, it says in Hebrews 7:25, therefore He is also able to save forever those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. The death of Christ, it satisfies fully the anger and wrath of God that was for me because of my sin. His sinless life satisfies the demand of God's holy law. And when we're a Christian, that's applied to us. Do you know that? It is imputed to us. This means God is no longer angry with the Christian. It means all of their sin has already been punished in Christ, and the demand of God's law has already been fulfilled by Jesus on their behalf. Talk about faithful. God looks at you, Christian, as if you have perfectly obeyed his entire law because of what Jesus has done on your behalf. This is the gospel. For our sake, he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. This is crazy. I was thinking about this morning. In the same way our sin was imputed to Christ, his perfect obedience is imputed to us. So in the same way Jesus paid, was rewarded, if you will, for our sin, we're rewarded for his righteousness. And we want to question whether or not God's faithful. It doesn't get better than that. And everything else in life needs to be viewed under that. Under that. And if that's not enough, which it is, but if Christ as our high priest is day and night representing us to the Father. He goes to the Father on your behalf, petitioning for you, pleading for you, defending you. And as we saw in that video, all the accusations of Satan against the child of God fall on deaf ears. Why? Because Christ intercedes and he says, hey, I've already paid for that. I've already taken the punishment for that sin guilt. And the Father looks at the Christian and says, blameless. Acquitted. Innocent. I'm far from innocent. But if I'm in Christ, that's the assurance of our salvation. The assurance of my salvation is built upon Christ and his faithfulness, not mine. And now I'm not saying that we get to live however we want because of that. We know that if you died to sin, how can you live in it? And a true Christian understands that and strives to be faithful. A true Christian doesn't abuse grace. They do unknowingly and at times, but it breaks their heart. They strive to be faithful to God, as weak and pitiful as that it may be at times. We're left with, like Peter, Lord, you know my heart. What am I going to say? My behavior doesn't always line up with it, but you know my heart. Charles Spurgeon said, the glory of God's faithfulness is that no sin of ours has ever made him unfaithful. God's faithfulness to his people, to you this morning, if you have trusted in Christ, is contingent upon his character, his covenant, his word, not on you and your faithfulness. And what causes the Christian to marvel at LMF is that even when they are unfaithful, and so often that is, God is still faithful. Amen, if you know what I'm saying. One of the most astounding things to me is that after all these years since Christ has saved me, that I am shocked and I am still so far from where I should be. And I fall flat on my face and I don't give him what he deserves. Yet what's even more astounding with my consistent unfaithfulness is his consistent faithfulness, despite my unfaithfulness. Not once has he failed me. I will fail him today, multiple times. I probably already did this morning. But God, being rich in mercy, as the years pass, I really do become more and more aware that if God does not keep me, I won't make it. I won't make it. Our hope is his faithfulness. Look at this new covenant promise. Jeremiah 32:40. I will make with them an everlasting covenant, that I will not turn away from doing good to them. And I will put the fear of me in their hearts, that they may not turn from me. God says, I will put the fear of me in their hearts so that they won't turn from me. Where's your hope placed in regard to persevering till the end? Is it that you're just a strong, mature Christian and, hey, you've gotten through other things? I got a strong will and I'm banking that no matter what happens in life, I can be sure that I'm just going to hang on to Jesus because I love Jesus so much. And I've hung on to him this far. There's nothing that's going to keep me from, although others walk away, as Peter said, I will die with you, Lord. Is that your hope in persevering till the end? I mean, what's your hope for tomorrow, that you will wake up tomorrow morning and still have faith in Jesus? People are falling away at just left and right. What keeps you from being one of them? What keeps me from being one of those apostate people that says, I believe, but I don't believe anymore. I'm done with all this. What is my hope that tomorrow I'll wake up and still trust in Jesus? Is it because my faith is so strong? Is it me hanging onto that branch? That's foolish. Foolish, foolish, foolish. God's promise here in Jeremiah 32 is that he has put the fear of him in the hearts of his people, in the heart of the Christian. And the result, because of what God has done, i.e. put his fear into you, you won't turn from him. You fear him. Where'd that fear come from? God's faithfulness. My hope in persevering to the end is not my ability to keep myself saved, but in Elameth's faithful saving grace and sovereign power to keep me. True assurance looks at the faithfulness of Christ and clings to it. So, loved ones, if you are in Christ, you can rest in his faithfulness to see you through. You can rest in his promise to finish the work that he's began in you. You can rest in the hope that all the hardship and the pain and the struggle is ultimately the Lord's faithful provision to make you more like Christ. And he has not left you. He's right there with you. And he will see you through to the end. Amen? But if you are not in Christ, you have no hope. You have no hope. Your most righteous deeds fall infinitely short of a perfectly holy God. Unless you can stand here and before God say that you're a perfect person that's never sinned, not even once, you need a Savior, and you are not that. So come to Christ. He invites you, come, find refuge in me. Place your hands in the scars. See that he was pierced for your transgressions, that he was crushed under the weight of your iniquity so that you could be reconciled and forgiven. Next, Elameth is faithful to give us victory in life. God wants us to live in victory over sin in our life. We have victory. He wants us to walk as overcomers against the enemies in this world. David was so in tune with this about God. Listen to David's words in 2 Samuel 22, verses 2 through 4. The Lord is my rock and my fortress. Seems like David can't get away from that, right? The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge. He's my shield, the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge, my Savior. You save me from violence. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. And then down in verse 31 of 2 Samuel 22, David says, this God, this rock, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in him. Who needs a shield? I do. I need a shield, especially when I look at the world now. I need a shield for my children because the enemy is capturing children. I need a shield for my wife. I need a shield for myself. I need a shield for my church. I need a shield, and Christ is that only shield. God promises to be our rock, our fortress, our deliverer, our refuge, our strength, our stronghold. 2 Thessalonians 3:3, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. Now, this doesn't always mean that God is going to keep you from being attacked, that you're just never going to get attacked, that you're never going to have opposition, that Satan's never going to get in your in the mix and make things a mess for you. We know that. Look at Job and Peter. We know God allows this to happen sometimes, but even in that, he's faithful to keep us from falling away. I want to use Peter's life as an example. But not to see Peter, to see Christ. Luke 22:31-32. This is Jesus speaking. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. It was Christ who gave Peter not only the grace to make it through the sifting of Satan, but it was the faithfulness of Christ that gave Peter the power to overcome it and come back to strengthen his brothers. Why did Peter not fail? His faith, why didn't it not fail? Jesus told us, I've prayed for you. I'm interceding on your behalf. God has faithfully empowered us to live a holy life by giving us His Spirit. He's given us His Word, which extinguishes the lies of the enemy. And He's made Himself an ever-present help that we can draw near to in times of temptation. And when we do sin, thirdly, Elymath is faithful to forgive us our sin and cleanse us. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us. This is an overwhelming statement. If God forgave us without punishing our sin, He would cease to be just, right? But God forgives us justly because He's already punished our sin at the cross. So He doesn't withhold forgiveness to His children. But this also implies that if God did withhold forgiveness from His children, if you as a Christian, as trusting in Christ, went to God and said, God, please forgive me, you were genuine and you were seeking forgiveness and mercy for your sin, and God turns you away, He would actually be unjust for not forgiving you because He's already punished your sin. He would have to bring your sin back up and repunish it. We don't even allow that in the court of law, in man's court. That's double jeopardy. You can't be charged again for something you already paid the debt for. So God would be unjust if He chose to not forgive you. Secondly, God's faithfulness to forgive us is also because of His faithfulness to His Word, His covenant. Hebrews 8:12, for I will be merciful toward their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. I need to be reminded of these words this week. For I will be merciful toward their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. I know it can be difficult at times to understand how God can forgive us, especially when we're constantly reminded that we sin against Him. But I have to know that He's faithful to forgive us, to cleanse us when we go to Him in brokenness and humility, confessing our sin. There is no sin that cannot be brought to Elymet and forgiven. There is no sin that can't be washed by the blood of Christ. And so we don't need to be fearful and run from God when we sin, thinking that He's just waiting to punish us. He's punished Jesus so that the Christian can come boldly, knowing that they'll receive forgiveness and grace. Lastly, Elymet's faithfulness is seen in that he is faithful to uphold us in our affliction. One of the most difficult times to trust God's faithfulness is when something tragic happens to us. And it's actually in those times that reveal whether or not we do trust God. Ray Ortland captures this idea when he said, trust in God, not explanations from God, is the pathway through suffering. So often we demand an explanation from God. God, why are you letting this happening? What is the purpose in all this? Why haven't you done something? I prayed and you didn't do what I asked, and so I'm done with this. That will only lead you to a darker place. The pathway through the suffering is trusting in God, that He's good. And what cradles and nurtures my trust in God is knowing that He's faithful, that no matter what it is I go through, no matter what it appears to be, God's faithfulness has not wavered. And again, this is true. This is a promise for the Christian. If you have not trusted in Christ, this is not true for you. This refuge, this hope, this steadfastness is found in Christ and Christ alone. We must come to Christ, but come we can. Come we must. Today. Now. Giving myself to Him. I've made a mess of my life. Lord, You have to fix it because I can't. I'm broken, and You are the one that fixes broken things. So here I am. And you know, even though God may allow affliction and suffering in our lives, He never forgets us or leaves us alone in it. He's always there. But how do we determine the truthfulness of that? By a feeling, right? Well, God feels so distant, so He must not be here. We cannot do that. Our feelings will lead us astray. God said He'll never leave you nor forsake you. That's all we need. God has said it. It is true. I love what Sam Storm says. He says, if only for a moment, please hear this morning, church. If only for a moment, take your eyes off yourself and your circumstances. Take your eyes off the ways of this world and all rival claimants and look at who God is. Ponder His mighty deeds. This isn't to say your soul or circumstances aren't important. It simply means that you are in the hands of an omnipotent God, an all-powerful God, whose ability to act on your behalf is equaled only by His passionate affection for you as His child, whose strength is without end, and whose sovereignty covers the expanse of the heavens. God's desire isn't to minimize your life and struggles and disappointments. His intent is for you to gain hope, knowing that nothing can wrench you from the loving arms of a God like this. If it wasn't for those struggles and those disappointments and the pain, how would I know the comfort of God? How would I know the peace of God? How would I know the rescuing of God? I wouldn't. Nothing can wrench me from the loving arms of my shepherd. And if I'm struggling to grab hold of this and believe this, it's really one of two reasons. A, I'm not a Christian. Or B, I am a Christian and I simply need to be reminded and fix my gaze again on who Elimelech is. Listen to Elimelech's response to his people when they thought God forgot them in their affliction. I've read this verse many times. Isaiah 49, 14 through 16. But Zion said, the people of God said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. We've all felt that. Can a woman forget her nursing child? That she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. What I need in my affliction, in my pain, in my sorrow is not some explanation from God as to why He's allowing it, which if He gave me, He doesn't owe me, but if He gave me, I wouldn't understand it anyway. But I need to be comforted with the truth of who God is and what He's promised. Christian, you were engraved on the palms of His hands. How can He forget you? He still bears the scars. Christ suffered on my behalf. Christ is faithful to me in my suffering and has not left me to myself. And to be sure of that, I say again, look to the cross. You were engraved on the palms of Jesus' hands. His blood was shed on your behalf. He drank the cup of God's wrath for you. How could He ever forget you? Answer, he can't. And when I begin to take my eyes off of my suffering, and that's difficult at times, and I place them on his suffering, my suffering begins to pale in comparison. But not only that, I begin to identify with Christ in his suffering. Because I know, listen to this, that his suffering was substitutionary. The suffering that Jesus endured was substitutionary, meaning what he suffered was actually what I should have suffered and deserve to suffer. So when I look to Calvary, I don't just see God dying on a cross, I see what I deserve. That's what I should be on that cross with the wrath of God being poured out. I should have had my flesh ripped from my body. His suffering was my suffering. And you know what brings me so much hope in identifying with Christ in suffering? Paul understands this and he writes about it. Romans 8, 16 through 18. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if we are children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order, so this is conditional clause, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider, and Paul was no stranger to suffering, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time, whatever you're suffering right now, Christian, it's not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in you, to you, in Christ. I find hope in my suffering because God has promised that if I suffer with him, I will be glorified with him. That I will be raised to glory with him at his return. And it will be with a glory that far outweighs my temporary struggles in this life, though painful they are. That's what I need to be reminded of in my affliction. That my momentary light affliction is producing for me an eternal weight of glory that far outweighs anything in this life. And because Elamet said it was so, it is so. Guys, we have to know that God is faithful. This is one of God's attributes that we cling to in times of trouble, in times of death, in times of divorce, in times of sickness, in times of temptation, in times of doubt. Our God is forever faithful. And it's vitally important for us to know that though we should strive to be faithful to the Lord, that we should seek to cultivate faithful obedience in our lives to him, the reality is our faithfulness is shaky and inconsistent. Some days, man, I'm trusting God. And other days, I'm trusting myself. And if our salvation and our hope depends on our faithfulness, you might as well leave. Go find something else to do. But it's not. It's on his faithfulness. If God said he would keep you, he will keep you, Christian. No matter what fire he leads you through. If God said you're forgiven, then you are forgiven. If God said he would draw near to you when your heart is broken and your spirit is crushed, then you can call upon him knowing well that he will draw near to you. If God said he would use all of your hardship and difficulty for his glory in your life, then don't call it vain and pointless because it's not. Because God said it wasn't. He's doing something with it in your life. You don't see it now, but that's called faith. God, your God, your Savior, your Redeemer, the one true living God is Elamet. He's the faithful God. Amen. Biff, will you hand out the elements? I will say that if you have yet to trust in Christ, I ask that you abstain from partaking of this meal. This is for those who have come to Christ. But, as I said a couple times, today is the day of salvation. You turn from yourself and trusting in your own ability to be right before God, to save yourself, and you cast yourself at his feet. Jesus, your death saves me. Your blood washes me. I have no hope apart from you. I'm giving myself to you. I repent. I turn from my sin. I turn from my own life, and I give myself to you. And then I live this life for His glory. That can be done today, and if that's true of you today, then partake of this meal because it's for you. When told to revile Christ by recanting of his faith or else die, Polycarp responded, 86 years have I served him, and he has done me no wrong. How then can I blaspheme my king who saved me? As his executioner seized his wrists to nail him to the stake, Polycarp stopped them. He who gives me strength to endure the fire will enable me to do so without the help of your nails. As the flames began, Polycarp prayed one last prayer. I bless you, Lord, because you have thought me worthy of this day and this hour to be numbered among your martyrs in the cup of your Christ. Soon the flames engulfed him, but strangely they did not consume him. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego before him, Polycarp was fireproof. Instead of the stench of burning flesh, the scent of frankincense wafted through the Colosseum. Using a spear, the executioner stabbed Polycarp through the flames. Polycarp bled out, but not before the 12th martyr of Smyrna had lived out the Apostle John's exhortation, "Be faithful even to the point of death." What was the fuel that flamed Polycarp's faithfulness even to the point of death? Well, he tells us, 86 years I have served my king, and he has never failed me. Where else am I going to go? Where else are you going to go?